once I was between the car and the fuel rig when it went boomf as the fire ignited on the exhaust, and the other time I was between the car and the live pit lane, and by the time the driver's door was open, I was already over the Armco up against the pit wall. I'd learned my Peugeot pit fire lesson. Here's our standings after 17 hours of the Le Mans 24 hours. It is still a Toyota 1-2, 32 seconds separate the number 8, the leader, from the number 7 car. G-Drive, Hannes Barthez and Signatec Alpine still remain 1-2-3 in LMP2. In the GTE Pro class, the 92 car just dodged another bullet. They lead from teammates 91, Ford third and fourth, Corvette fifth, Ford in sixth position. The Dragon Speed number 10 car is in the pits and will not come out. In the GTE AM class, Dempsey Proton 77 still leads from Keating Motorsports Ferrari, and the Spirita Race Ferrari is in third place. The 99 chrome green Porsche, that is the Proton car, is in fourth ahead of Team Project One and Ebi Motors. So in the top six in GTE AM, four cars are from Stuttgart, Zuffenhausen, or wherever else you like to say that. All four of the top six cars in AM class are Porsches. Our retirements are in numerical order, more than are shown on the screen, in fact. The number four by Colles, LMP1 car. Now the number 10, Dragon Speed, LMP1 car, and the number 6, Ginetta, LMP1 car. In LMP1 also, we've lost the number 17, SMP Racing, BR1. In LMP2, the number 34, Jackie Chan DC Racing car, has gone by the board, as has the number 40, G-Drive, Orica, and those are our P2 retirements, just the two. In GTE Pro, just two cars have gone as well, the 82 BMW, Augusto Farfus, Antonio Felix da Costa and Alex Sims car, and the Roman Dumas, Timo Bernhardt and Sven Müller 94 IMSA entered Porsche, and only one AM car has gone, so we've only lost three GT cars in total. The only AM car to go is the 98 Aston Martin, and Paul Dallalana was at the wheel when that car speared off at the Porsche curves. And our race leader, Peter, is in the pit lane and out again quickly.
Yep, he's... hang on. So when he was in the lead, Conway is now back in the lead. So those cars are still running fairly close together. Now on board with Conway. Just coming on to... the Mulsanne straight in a second through Tête Rouge. Twenty-six seconds separates the two Toyotas at the front of the race. And they are nine laps up on the Rebellion.
It's interesting, isn't it, that the number 8 car has served two stop-and-go penalties. Number 7 has served one, and yet they are still so close together. We saw after the first penalty for Seb Buemi that the crew of number 8 were able to reel in the number 7 car. It took them a long while, but they did get there. So now it's not hitting stuff, not making silly errors, and all of the other rules of Le Mans that apply, because although we're in daylight, we've still got just under 7 hours of racing to go. Now, a standard world endurance race is a mere 6 hours. So basically we've got almost all the track time of the World Endurance Weekend still to go. Well, Duncan is down in the pit lane with Daniel Serra, last year a race winner with Aston Martin. How's his race going this weekend?
Yeah, what a difference a year makes for Daniel Serra. Last year a race winner with Aston Martin, this year you're dressed in red, you're in the Ferrari. How is the Le Mans 24 hours going for you this year?
We had a puncture on the first thing to compromise our race. We are still pushing and trying to help them to score the maximum points for the championship.
what's going to be the strategy for you for the rest of this? Are you guys going to push as hard as you possibly can?
Yeah, I think now we have to think about the championship. We have to push, try to score maximum points. I think I'll be back in the car in 4 hours, something like this, and let's see if I can have more fun.
And what do you do from now? Will you go and have a little lie down? Will you take some fluids, a massage maybe?
Yeah, I'll try to rest a bit, recover, check a bit the data, see where we can improve for the next run.
Yeah, thank you very much. Well, there you go, guys. A slightly more approachable EF course driver.
There you go. Well, it's slightly more approachable.
Scott, we're going to hit this lap for a driver change. Drink tube, air tube. And your belts. Ryan is getting in.
AF Corsa not having the best race. The 52 cars, the only one that's really not had real problems, and even they had a puncture early on. James Calado closing in on them in the 51 car, the world champions, they had a puncture as well. 71 has had even more problems. That's the car regularly driven by Sam Bird and Davide Rigon. And none of the Ferraris have really looked much like they're going to win a race here. Driver change for our GTE Pro Class race leaders. Kevin Estra out, and that means Michael Christensen gets back in. Now, the two of them have got identical Pink Pig liveried helmets. The difference is that the third driver, Laurens Vanthoor, has got a not quite identical and matte-coloured Pink Pig liveried helmet.
Right.
Yeah, so they've all gone the whole hog.
Oh, very good.
That just came out as I was realising it. So on board with our race leader, Mike Conway, in the pit lane again. Now, they were both in, 8 and 7, a couple of laps ago to serve a penalty. Now they're in for fuel and service. Conway is back out. Thomas Laurent is back out in third place. As down the pit lane comes the battle between Scott Dixon in the Ford and Mike Rockenfeller in the Corvette. And this is the battle for fourth place in GTE Pro.
It's also the battle for supremacy of the American marks.
It absolutely isn't, because Jerry Hand is in front of both of them, but it could be. And in actual fact, you know, when you're battling for fourth with just under 7 hours to go, you could easily be battling for a podium in an hour or two. You know, one incident, one mishap. We talked about the narrow squeak that Kevin Estra had a moment or two ago when Tracy Crone's car spun in front of him at Arnage. That's all you need to change the face of the race. Mm.
You know, we were talking earlier on, and I didn't miss the was it Pierre Guidi interview? He had a bit of a rant. So, yeah, I mean, talking about lap times, though, you know, they're not, it's not like they're not doing the same lap times as the front guys. Maybe that it's harder to do the lap times, but, you know, they're still doing 52s, 51s, and there's Aston Martin consistently lapping at 54s, and we don't hear them complaining too much.
Yes, it was a rather one-sided conversation, and I think, unfortunately, the driver thought he was talking to the organisers of the BOP panel as opposed to poor old Duncan
Muppets
in the pit lane. Duncan, I'm sure, is capable of maybe giving them a bit of a weight restrictor change or something like that. But
maybe he was aware that I was asleep in my bed and therefore the broadcast was in need of a small rant.
Yes, you always need a bit of a rant. You know, every hour or so we need a rant.
Every hour on the hour.
Check out that rubber down the edge of the track there, all the way down. So much of it. And as you say, we've still got some time to go. By the end of this race, that is going to be absolutely littered down there.
Now, we talked to the number 52 AF Corsa Ferrari crew. They have a drive-through penalty for speeding in the pit lane at their last stop.
So Richard Leitz getting out of that number 91 car from second place.
Please tell me, is Pierre Guidi in that car?
In the Ferrari, in the 52.
Yeah.
I can't remember which one he's in, actually.
Wielander's in
Yes, he's in the...
No, it's Giovinazzi.
Sorry.
Yeah,
he's
Tony
in the
51. Yeah, now, Alessandro Pierre Guidi, of course, the world champion with James Calado last year in the GTE Pro Class. So clearly, because he's not yet world champion, he's having a bit of a rant about BOP. Now, in fairness, Ferrari weren't at the front in every qualifying session at every track last year either, but they rode their luck when they could. They had, you know, they took points when they couldn't win, and they won when they should have. So that's the season you need, isn't it? That's the season you need to be world champion. You don't need the best of everything. You don't need the fastest car. Well, it helps, but you need to get all the ducks in a row and not make silly mistakes. And that was the difference. The difference between 71 and 51 last year was the 51 Ferrari just kept having bad luck. There's Patrick Dempsey looking about as alert as everybody else does before they spring into action. He's raced here and been here as a team owner. Has he got one of those new 50th anniversary golf watches? I bet he has. Brand new 50th anniversary Tag Heuer Monaco to celebrate 50 years since golf won their first Le Mans back in 1960. Stop it, boys. That's contagious. You see? It's catching.
Oh, it's absolutely caught on there. They're out.
It's amazing, isn't it, what fatigue does. It's broad daylight, it could actually be raining, but they are so exhausted, even the noise of a Le Mans field going by isn't enough to wake them up. Never mind some bloke stomping across the hard standing. Sebastian Buemi leads in LMP1 for Toyota. Roman Rusanov still in front for G-Drive. He's doing a lot of hours in that car. And Michael Christensen leads in GTE Pro for Porsche. And it is a Porsche in the lead of the GTE Am class as well, with Matt Campbell, the junior driving Aussie, ahead in the Pro class for Dempsey Proton. And there's Danny Binks in the Corvette Racing garage. Corvette Racing celebrating 20 years in the business this year. Doug Feehan showing absolutely no sign of wanting or needing to retire at any stage.
Or aging.
No, indeed.
Yeah, he looks as young as he did, and doesn't he's got as much as energy.
Doesn't
as
he? Had. I don't want to look at the portrait in his attic. I mentioned earlier, actually, in the week, there is a gentleman who walks his dog down my road, who I see occasionally. He always wears shorts as well. And as I catch the sight of him in the distance, I go, the very first time I saw him, I thought, what's Doug Feehan doing here? I swear to God, he is the living image of Doug Feehan. Quite the oddest thing. It's a relatively quiet pit lane. So actually, if Duncan can summon up the courage to go and talk to Elton Julian, might actually be able to hear what's happened to the number 10 Dragon Speed car. It is out of the race. And fortunately, they are done. We are down to four front-running P1 cars, and they are the four that we expected, pretty much, the two Toyotas and the two Rebellions. I mean, there's no reason why Rebellion's car should be any better. It's as new as everybody else's. But they just seem to have done well. Well, on his way to Elton Julian, Duncan has tripped over one of seven IndyCar drivers in the field and one of four Indy 500 winners. What's Scott Dixon been up to in the last couple of hours?
Well, it's always great to catch up with Dixie, that's for sure. And you come to Le Mans carrying a good bit of form with a couple of good IndyCar races. But how has the Le Mans 24 hours been going for you so far?
Yeah, I'd have to say the form hasn't probably carried over. You know, we've been struggling a little bit just with straight-up speed. You know, the first stint seems to go okay with all three drivers, and then we struggle with the last one. Just, you know, abusing the tyre a little too much, but it's definitely competitive. You know, the GT category is pretty crazy right now, but, you know, kudos to the 68, you know, the other side of our team. They're doing a hell of a job, I think, running third at the moment. But, yeah, we've just struggled with outright pace, so, you know, we'll try and keep working on it. Maybe a little bit of late luck will come our way, and we can try and, you know, snatch a podium here.
What's the track conditions like? Because we've seen quite a lot of cars go off, a lot of gravel and a lot of debris, you know, pick up. What are the conditions like for you?
I'd say the conditions right now are pretty good. You know, they're pretty desirable. At least for our car, it seems to be, you know, getting more in the window. Last night, you know, my stint around 2 or 3 in the morning was a little rough. You know, we just seemed to really wear the tyres out quickly. But this morning, we seemed to, you know, just hold the lap times right there. So that was a lot better. But track conditions seem good. You know, these slow zones and things are a bit crazy, man. It's, you know, even the restarts earlier on in the race were pretty full on.
Do you guys struggle with a low track temperature?
Yeah, it seems that way. You know, for us in the Ford GT, you know, we have such a slick car that we have really good top speed, you know, hence in the, they take power away from us, so out of the corners and on those restarts and now the slower speed corners, you know, it's a bit rough on us and it's especially once the tyres start to wear off. But it's a lot of fun out there and love being here, and you know, hopefully we can have a good result there.
Thanks very much, Dixie.
Thanks, mate.
Okay, let's head down to Dragon Speed, and I won't get Elton Martin, I promise you.
Good luck. Well, we'd like to hear from him. I mean, I know a lot of fans of Dragon Speed would love to hear from him as well. Their race has ended with the garage door down rather than with the team leaning over the pit wall to welcome their new toy to the end of the race. But hopefully their fortunes will improve. It's certainly a very ambitious and well-run team. See the leader coming by, the number 47 Villorba Corsa car. Now, I wasn't on air when it had that change of nose from blue and white to black, fresh out of the truck. We haven't had a chance to livery it up. So that's obviously had a bit of an off somewhere. And I would hesitate to guess that it was either probably at the end. Ah, now he had a spin, thinking about it, at the end of the Mulsanne straight into Mulsanne corner. Kelly McNish inquiring as to the breakfastedness or otherwise of Mr. Alan McNish. I've informed him that he's had neither breakfast nor tunnocks yet this morning. He's on an alternate strategy.
He just started with a wee gin and tonic just to get the day going. He does smell good, though. He's had a shower in his little container, hasn't he?
He has. We've released the Scott from his container. I tell you what, Scott Dixon's not wrong. The first 4 or 5 hours of the race were just utter insanity, and especially in the GT class. We've got those two safety cars together that bottled up pretty much the entire GT field, with the exception of our current leaders, the 92 Porsche. Mm. We had 10 GT cars in a train.
I kind of miss it now.
It was
great at the time, and it's not going to come back again during this race, I don't think, unless something real special happens. But it's pretty settled out front with the two Porsches. The 92 car gaining from the early safety cars, just a bit of luck, right positioning. They gained themselves two minutes, 3 minutes, and they just held it all the way through.
Replay showing Ted Pappas having a loop around at the Dunlop curve. He's in fifth position. I've just had the flimsiest flim-flam excuse. Come on, on air this time instead of shamedly into my headset. Tell us.
Well, I was still thinking about Alan McNish's breakfast, and I forgot what I said to you a minute ago. But
what you said is you weren't able to get an interview with Elton Julian.
No, I had an interview with Elton Julian. Unfortunately, believe it or not, the microphone wasn't involved in it. He wants to give us some good news to go with the bad news, which we know about, guys. So they're just making sure everything's good with the P2 car. They're expecting in maybe quite soon. So I'll go back in 20 minutes and he will give us something.
All right, very good. That's like... And then Kylie and I got married. The bad news is I woke up. I got an interview with Elton Julian. The bad news is the microphone wasn't involved.
I think that's the first and only time I'll ever heard the sort of sentence with Kylie Minogue and Elton Julian in the same one.
No, that'll be the second Kylie Minogue reference we've had. Jules and I it all got started with a little moment earlier on when Fernando Alonso was in the car in the middle of the night, and he said, "I have the rhythm of the night. Do you want me to stay in?" And then I teased Jules with who actually had a hit with Rhythm of the Night, and then we got into a bit of a song theme.
This is the rhythm... No, is that something different?
It was. El DeBarge. Yeah. No, you're right. Absolutely, El DeBarge. So Fernando Alonso got maximum points for accidental one-hot hit wonder disco tune naming in the middle of the
accidental.
Night. Yeah, it absolutely was. Oh, talking about the rhythm of night, you haven't got the rhythm of the day in the IDEX sport car, jumping the curbs there.
It's the GM Ford battle that's on its way again. Mm-hmm. Garcia Briscoe this time, 63-69. On board with the 69 coming into Ford.
And the places have swapped because the Ford was ahead of the Corvette going into the pit lane, so have they had a little bit more work on the 69 car? What they haven't done is change the tatty tape.
There was 3 seconds more in the pit lane in the last stop for the Ford, which is probably about right, considering...
Fastest lap from the Ford, Ryan Briscoe that time around.
Yeah.
350.9.
Cooper up there so, to 2 seconds.
The track really is coming back to the Fords now.
But it's still 3 tenths slower than Garcia's last lap. Garcia 350.6 on his last lap as well.
True. Now,
both of the BMWs have had full brake changes. Anybody else in the GT class had a brake change yet?
I think the majority of...
Well, there's a Ferrari in as well. I think a lot of teams used that slow zone time to do the pit stop and to change brakes.
Sorry, I wasn't actually on air at the time when the Ford broke the nose. Do you know what happened?
No, I wasn't either.
And neither was I.
But it looks like it's a big crack right up the centre. Hello.
Yeah, so it looks like he's just run into the back of somebody or had a very slight excursion against the barriers. Yeah, if that was an LMP1 car or LMP2 car, it would have been a work of a moment to change the nose. But it's a work of a slightly longer moment to stick a whole load of gaffer on the GT car.
Still, it doesn't seem to have hampered it too much.
This is true. Although, you see, the problem with the GT class in Pro and Am is something that Alan will be very familiar with throughout his Audi career, is that when you've got so many similar cars, and particularly if you've got two or three or four teammates, or two or three teammates, it doesn't have to be a big mistake to cost you the race, or a big problem. It has to be the tiniest of problems. Yeah, the need to change brakes where your teammates don't because one of the rotors cracks, or you get caught behind the wrong safety car. You know, sometimes something like that early in the race is undoable, and we're seeing that at the moment in the GT class. When were those two safety cars in the first 2 or 3 hours of the race?
A little bit later than that. It was about 4 or 5 hours when they came pretty much back to back on the safety cars, and up until that point the BMW was right in the mix, the Fords were right in the mix, Corvette was sort of hanging on the tail, the Ferrari was in there as well.
Well, the BMWs were there on pace, but that both cars had a left front damper failure, and so that cost them. One of them has also had an excursion, gone off, and that's sort of dropped them out of the race. So we've only got one BMW left, and that is now a long way down in 15th place in class.
So I'm thinking that's had more than a damper change, because 9 laps behind now, which means they've had at least something as big as the damper change wrong.
They had damper change and they did brakes on that at the same time. Here's another class battle shaping up. There are quite a number of them, actually. Felipe Albuquerque 2.7 seconds behind Mimo Rojas in the pole-sitting IDEX sport car. And that gap has been coming down. Albuquerque, the only driver in the number 22 United Autosports car who has ever started at Le Mans before. So two of the 39 rookies are in that car. So there's a bit of responsibility there when you're in that position, isn't there? As a driver, you know, obviously you've got to go as quickly as you can, stay out of trouble, yada, yada, yada. But the young kids in the team, Hugo de Sadelain and the other driver, whose name escapes me for the moment, it really is quite... I'm quite tired now. You know, they're looking for all that help from you because they don't know where they're going, what they're doing in terms of every element of the race, you know, where to be at the right time and all of that sort of stuff.
Yeah, that's it. Sometimes a young driver like that just needs an arm around him and a bit of guidance. And we all know they're quick, but it's not all about being quick. It's about being consistent. It's about not making those little errors, keeping your head when it gets hot out there. Yeah. And as I said, if you've got a good team around you and a good team manager, and you get on well with your teammates and you're driving with them all year, then you form a bit of a family and a bond, and you guide each other.
In fact, the two rookies are not one. In fact, neither of the two rookies is Hugo de Sadelair. One of them is the joint youngest man in the race. That is 18-year-old Phil Hansen, and the other rookie in the car is yet another Scot. That's Paul de Resta. So he's
another rookie,
a rookie, but not an 18-year-old any longer. So, yeah, one of 39 rookies in the field. And there's United Autosports team. And we're talking during the night about Ginetta's win in the GT class. That was a good decade ago with the Panos Esperanti, and that car driven by, among others, Lawrence Tomlinson, boss of Ginetta, here with Ginetta, and Richard Dean, who is now running the United Autosports program with co-owner Zach Brown. And the third driver, again, we had a long karting conversation during the middle of the night, because the third driver was Luke Hines, son of multiple world kart champion late Martin Hines, and he has returned to the karting fold, and his racing consists entirely of karting nowadays. Oh, now there's what happens under a football field. You can see them putting a new undersoil heating there in the MM Arena, and that was due to be used for concerts this weekend, but for reasons that were very obvious there, they're putting a new floor in. They couldn't have lots of punters in there. So last night's concert, Charlene Spiterian, Texas, the night before in the public arena for free, was Jamiroquai. Peter was there, rocking out.
I was. I had canned heat in my heels.
Did you indeed? And the first night's gig was the great Dr. Feelgood. Now here is the Krohn Racing car and the number 28 IDEC car. And Loic Duval, TDS car rider, Loic Duval needs to get by the number 44 Eurasia Run entry.
It's Tracy Krohn at the wheel of that car.
Now, each driver must do a minimum of 6 hours for the car to qualify for points. So that is at least three triple stints or four double stints, I reckon, on a 10-lapper for the LMP2 cars. So driver's doing an awful lot of mileage, and I have to say some of them doing a lot more. Roman Rusinov, I think, is probably going to end up doing a full third of the race. Well,
Nicky, are you happy to do a double stint? Are you happy to do a double stint? So finish this one and another 14 laps, question?
That means it's the last one, I guess. Why not?
Negative, it's not the last one. You still get some more at the end.
Okay, how long have I been in the car now? Feels like ages.
Time-wise, it was quite a bit. Driving time, not so much.
I'm happy to stay in whatever you prefer, Richie. I'm also happy to get out, by the way.
It would make life a little bit easier if you stay in the car. So it's okay. You can do a double stint now and then at the end again.
Yeah, no problem. No problem.
There you go, Nicky Katzberg giving the engineers all sorts of options. I'm happy to stay in. I'm also quite happy to get out. But does that mean the rhythm is good? But actually, I quite need a wee.
Quite possibly, yeah.
Yes. I was hydrating so much during the night that my 2 hours 45 snooze became just 2 hours.
The other thing is they're two laps down from the next car, so at the end of the day they're running around to finish the race as opposed to actually have any competition.
In
they were
15th place, I don't think they need to take it quite so seriously, and maybe Martin's in a bit middle of a game here or something, he might be playing Hill Dash 2 or something.
But that's the other thing is they were second at one point, and they were the ones that were really taking the charge to this and possibly bringing something out of it.
Well, you know, all of that is good news. They had a freak failure in a component that they've never had fail before. So the good news is the car is very competitive in its first year in the World Endurance Championship, its first year here at Le Mans. So we didn't quite get a real feel for the field in Spa, did we? You know, we had the new Aston Martins, we had the new BMW. The balance of performance has been massaged. I mean, saying it's been changed, yes, there are changes, but it's not throwing the baby out with the bathwater. They're trying to massage the position so things are just about as close as they can get. It's very encouraging, the pace that was shown by the BMWs. HE2 has gone out after Alexander Sims crashed in the Porsche curves earlier on, but HE1's still going.
Yeah, you're right. They started the weekend off on the back foot, back in the sort of position time-wise where they are now, 15th, and gradually worked their way up. And as you said, when the race started, they were one of the big benefits for that team to for the BMW to gradually move up. And as you say, they were up there fighting with the Porsches until they came across some damper issues, which hadn't shown up in all the testing they'd done. But of course, we know we come to Le Mans, it's a bit different than everywhere else, and things do show their heads here, and that car's a brand new car.
Talking about a brand new car, a car that was in the wars in the qualifying sessions, was this car riding on board with the 67 Ford GT, currently in fourth place, Harry Tinknell at the wheel, a 351.1, so the quickest of the GT runners at the moment. They seem to have found pace as the race has gone on. We heard that Scott Dixon in the sister car saying that in the daytime they're a bit better than what they are in the night time. But that car, from the championship point of view, is in a reasonable place. They didn't score any points with a pit failure and a big crash at Spa, but now they'll be a little bit better off. Not ideal with the Christensen car leading the race, but a little bit better off.
Yeah, we did see in testing, or was it qualifying, Andy Priel back the car into the wall at Tête Rouge, didn't we?
Yeah.
And it, funnily enough, the car didn't even stop. It bounced out of the tyre wall. He selected first and drove it back to the pits.
Yeah, proper rally driver effort that was. And then, of course, Tony Canaan bounced it off the barriers at the S's as well, didn't he? So, yeah, I did venture earlier on and regretted it as I started the sentence that Harry Tinknell was the only one who hadn't had a shunt in that car. But then he started early at Spa, so the others were just catching up. Now, there is work still going on the number five Ginetta, by the way. They found a hole in a pipe and they've fixed it. So the hope is that the number five Ginetta will go back out from the Manor garage. So we have not wielded the marker of doom over that one. It is on page two of the timing screen. And since page one is 30 cars, you will therefore assume that it is lower than 30 Earth. In fact, it is down in 50 Earth and has been passed by Mikel Elishin. Covers are going on the 82 BMW, and Alan has changed all the television screens, and we now have no pictures and no timing screen. Right, flick them back.
Naughty Alan.
Oh, okay.
Right, now, so we've got a campsite. There's a, you can right. See the campsite. There's, you know, there's a lot of people here, isn't there?
Yeah. Yes, there are. And in fact, all those serried rows of tents is something that has become quite a feature, and particularly actually because of the success of Tom Christensen. A Danish travel company started bringing fans down and now has just vast acreages of identical tents popped up that all the Danes stay in. The fact that Tom has retired sort of doesn't matter because it's become such a big event for Danish fans, either on TV. I mean, there's a huge Danish TV studio.
Bearing
right
in mind,
us.
The leader of GT and currently driving is a Danish driver too.
Yeah.
So there are the Danes around, you know, and Jan Magnussen, well, Michael Dane, Christensen.
Yeah, Dane training the Aston Martin as well.
Exactly, yeah.
There's your intimate Aston Martin knowledge really coming to the fore there. Completely forgot Marco Sorensen, Nicky team.
Yep.
Alan is now going to switch all the screens off, at which stage we'll be standing out and looking outside of the window gang.
Well, let's do that anyway, just for fun. Let's just
chicane.
We barely ever look out the window anymore.
Okay.
We're always just looking at screens.
Let's talk about what's coming past our window.
Zero. There's a golf buggy. No, that's a reflection.
No, still right. Nothing. Oh, there's three cars all together. The leader's in there, and so is the third LMP1 car. Right. While Alan breaks more TV screens, let's hear from Duncan Vincent down in the pit lane.
Yeah, the Dempsey car looks like it's coming in for a pit stop. Patrick Dempsey again rallies his troops, as he does. He's such a keen leader, isn't he? He gives them all a little shake, a hug, tells them how many laps all the cars come in. So great to see these guys on form today. And really, in the GT class, Porsche is what you want to be sitting in.
It is, isn't it? The Porsches have been very consistent and very quick, indecently quick, in fact. So they've had a lot of pace, and they've also had, so far, the good fortune. And the real problem with this race, always, and the problem that we've got right now...
Right, I've got it. I've got the picture back. Well, and I've turned the other TV off.
The problem we've got right now is we've got two
Three Samsung, four Samsung TVs.
Two Inept Scots and one remote control and four TVs that are all affected by the same remote. And our highly non-technical driver crew, you can tell why their drivers are not race engineers, are now flicking things on and off like billy-o. You can watch the G-Drive car, which, if I could see a timing screen, I would assume is still the leader of the LMP2 class. I can't see the timing screen because Peter's leaning in the way.
I'm trying to block off this signal so that Alan doesn't change this TV back.
And the number 22 car, Phil Hansen.
It's all gone wrong in the box here.
18 years old, the Londoner. And I ventured earlier on yesterday that he might be the youngest driver in the field. He's not actually the youngest driver in the field. He's one of two youngest drivers in the field, because we have our two youngest drivers both born on the same day. So two 18-year-olds born on the same day racing here at Le Mans.
And who's the oldest driver?
The oldest driver is Mark Patterson, who is 66 these days. And the second oldest driver is also the driver in the field with the most starts.
Jan Lammers.
Who celebrates his 30th win today, or this week.
30th win, did you say?
30th anniversary. Yeah, 30th anniversary of his win, yeah. 30th
would be quite impressive if it's 130.
That would be quite something.
Not even the great Tom Christensen is 130, or the great Alan McNish.
He'd like to let you know that he has.
Well, I'm not old enough to have done that, thankfully.
I beg to differ. Oh, not on your TV age, no, obviously.
Let's just take this back a minute, Alan. Right, so if you were 18 plus 30, that would take you to... Right, so... Are you there? Not quite there yet. You're close, though. You are close.
Thank you.
So if you were the youngest driver, let's say you were 60, then it would be possible. 16 or 17, yeah, okay.
We have had the youngest driver ever was a 16-year-old, wasn't he? He started the race two or three years ago.
There you go. Yeah.
Matt McMurray.
Which is illegal. Actually, back in the day, because you used to be 17 in the United Kingdom before you could get a road license, and you had to have a road license before you gave your racing license. Obviously, now times have changed, European Union and things like that.
Now, Pedro Rodriguez was refused an entry to Le Mans because he was only 15 when the team wanted him to come and race for the first time. And the French decided that no, even though
I think you have to draw the line somewhere.
Yeah. Well, actually, if you looked at his results, he looked pretty excited. What's, you know, the difference between 15 and 16? Look, I mean, nowadays, especially, you know, a 16-year-old has probably been racing for, you know, half of his years.
Yeah, yeah. I think just being practical about it as well. Yeah.
Now, Toyota tell us that the energy recovered after 17 hours of racing is enough to power 7,347 kettles and to make 44,082 cups of tea. Let's have three of those over here. Thank you very much. So 44,082 cups of tea at 10,907 baguettes a lap. That sounds like quite a decent breakfast to me.
Shall I put the kettle on?
No, I'll tell you what, it might suit you. Let's give it a go.
Winnie, I don't want to be racist, but Karun did
That's
make a good...
I'm going to be.
Karun made a fantastic cup of tea earlier on, and he's surely going to be back soon.
Now, all you need to do is fill the kettle with water and then...
So it sounds like too much work, but anyway, I'll get this sorted.
Let me know when that's finished, and I'll make the tea in a pot.
There's water going everywhere. It's all good, don't worry.
After the efficiency with which the pair of you sorted out the TV screens, I'm really worried about letting you handle electricity and water together.
Yeah.
Anyway, race leader LMP2 coming down into the left-hander Indy, and here's one of the Fords at Mulsanne. It's the 66 car.
Get round.
No, gravel. Not too much gravel, yeah. Look.
Kind of Billy Locked Johnston managed to just get in a little bit and then get it back out again.
That was a bit driving like a Billy, wasn't it? 67 is in, brake disc change.
Yeah.
So full brake setup, the entire thing made to be serviceable, just like a Le Mans prototype. all the GT cars are being built this way, because the understanding is you will need to change brakes.
So race leader in, Sebastian Buemi. 38 seconds ahead of second place Conway. I guess Conway will just sneak into the lead until he has to stop in a lap or so's time.
Yeah. Interesting, isn't it? Because of those safety cars, the Toyotas were back on the same lap schedule for fuel. Is the number seven going to go a lap longer again? They did that in the first two stops. The first stop, you understand, because you stagger your cars so they don't arrive together, or sometimes you do. Toyota have a habit of not doing that. But the number seven car went a lap longer on two, at least, of its early pit stops. And they ended up with a two-stop out of sync.
They were on a different fuel strategy or energy strategy. Mm. With the lift-off profiles coming into the various chicanes, you could see it quite dramatically with that. But I think that has sort of rebalanced itself out. Seven now leading, as you said, Conway through. So definitely there's a one-lap difference. Stop-and-go penalty for car 70, speeding in the pit lane. That's Eddie Cheever Jr.
Yes.
Double Junior.
Well, yeah, Eddie Cheever, the Grand Prix driver of the 80s and 90s and the IndyCar driver, was, in fact, Eddie Cheever Jr. So his son should be Eddie Cheever III. It is Eddie Cheever III, but he's known as Eddie Cheever Jr. Presumably because he's the junior ones of those surviving. I don't know whether Eddie Cheever the first, i.e. our current racer's grandfather, is still alive.
Thomas Laron, the Rebellion, third place, out to the pits.
Now they got their fuel rig. They didn't gaffer tape it back together, they tie wrapped it back together.
So a slow stop, 116, comparison to 105 for Toyota.
Well, don't forget, it's taking on more fuel, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah. But still, it's got a bigger fueling restrictor.
Yep.
To allow the fuel to go in. It's supposed to go in roughly in the same sort of time, 35 seconds.
Oh, I thought it was supposed to take 10 seconds low, 6 seconds longer or something, so that they spent more time stationary.
Yeah.
Belt and braces. You may well be right. You
rig
almost
restrictor.
Always are.
The rig restrictor is 2.35 millimetres larger for the non-hybrid than the hybrids.
And the flow rate is?
And the flow rate, maximal flow rate, is 80 to 108.
And that means that you're not going to do the maths.
It's too early in the morning.
It is too early, definitely. Ooh! Squeezing by the LMP2. That is the LMP2 car, isn't it? Not the number 11. Car, the SMP racing car. Number 11, Jenson Button fans, is currently
Forty-ninth.
I'm looking too low. It has crept up inside the top 50. Got ahead of number 5, Ginetta, which is still being worked on in the garage. So those are the last of our cars. And in fact, with Dragon Speed retiring from 5th, the Ginetta is 6th in LMP1 at the moment.
Examination the inside of the wheel rooms there.
Look at all those lumps and bumps. That's what is known in the trader's pickup. Those are all the bits of rubber that is rubbed off the tyre where it's been used. Look at the edge. Look, you can see that there are some of the little bits of tiny little rolled up balls of rubber actually on the edge of the carcass, haven't yet rolled off onto the track. Well,
that's on the outside of the tyre, so it's the one that's not getting all of the load because of the camber.
Yeah.
It's actually, if the pickup's on the inside edge, that's where the issues actually are. But what they were looking at there was the inside of the wheel rim, because it's a very, very close gap between the actual wheel brake drums and the rim itself. And if you get stones and things in there, it can actually score the inside of the rim. If that rim then gets used later on in the race for another set of tyres, then it can be a problem. Seven into the pits, Conway in.
Yep, so Buemi. Leader was in, now the leader is in. And this will flip-flop back again. Now, when you're in the second car in this position, there's only one thing you can do, which is basically drive faster and cleaner than the car in front. The gap's not massive. And you sort of assume, don't you, that unless there's a safety car, basically you might gain one lap in traffic, he might gain one lap in traffic, but overall, over 6 or 7 hours, it'll be broadly even. So does it just come down to driver pace and how you've got the car set up?
I think it comes down to a couple of things here. I think it comes down to no mistakes, and it comes down to the point of when Toyota decide that actually they've had enough racing for the day and they want to ensure 100% that this victory goes to them and it goes back to Japan.
Yep.
The trophy slipped through their fingers so many times over the years for silly little incidents that they don't want this one to go.
Replay a few of the incidents during the night. This is Alexander Sims going out in the BMW. That was pretty much the end of their race. Too much damage to continue. You saw the 37 Jackie Chan DC racing car spinning. That car continues. And this was the end of Dragon Speed's effort. Oof. It's a big old off, I'm afraid, and too much damage reasonably to be repaired for Elton Julian and his team. So the
who was in the car when
Ben Hanley?
Ben Hanley,
yeah,
that was a big shunt.
Was a big shunt. We've seen a few, haven't we? We've seen a few in that fast left in the Porsche curves. A lot of cars swapping ends in there. In fact, I think that runoff area. The runoff area hasn't claimed them, but going through the runoff area, two or three of our retirements have ended up ending their race there, which is possibly fewer than might have been the case in other years. Somebody sent us in a stat before midnight saying this car, the pink Porsche, had led 98.7% of the race. I think it's now into the sort of 99% of the race. The other car was ahead of it maybe once or twice early on, but that pink car has led relentlessly.
And for the last hour or so, that 51 Ferrari has been glued to it. Either it's been slightly in front or it's now behind.
Yeah. So 51 car is James Calado, our world champion from last year, trying to unlap himself because, as you can see in the graphic, first and eighth in class. Be an awful lot more entertaining if it was first and second in class, and this was how close the battle for the lead was 6 hours and 12 minutes to go. In fact, even with 12 minutes to go, this would be quite an entertaining race for the lead, as we saw at the end of the GT Pro class last year. But Jimmy Bruni, 2.5 minutes behind his teammate in second place.
Valiser there, who is the head of all the customer racing programs for Porsche. This certainly falls under his umbrella.
Yes, absolutely. And I wonder, I guess now, because he's been there so long, Michael Christensen and Kevin Estra before him are just used to the Ferrari being there, but how much do you want to let him go by just so he doesn't accidentally run into the back of you and cost you a win?
There's always a risk of something happening. You know, you've got two cars running like that. Him making a mistake. As we saw a little bit earlier on, Tracy Crone spinning right in front of both the cars. And you know, if suddenly Christensen has to slam on the brakes or change direction and the 51 Ferrari behind hasn't seen him and there's contact, you know, anything can happen.
Yep. It would, you know, again, from the pit wall, it would be infinitely preferable if the Ferrari either got on with it, got by, or picked up a problem. The problem is, for the Ferrari, Porsche is just that whisker quicker.
Or the Porsche could just pull away.
Yeah. Unfortunately, it can't. You can see the difference between the two cars. The Ferrari closes at the end on high speed. The Porsche just digs in and gets away early on out of the slow corner. Through comes the SMP car. Is that the number 11? No, it's 35. That's the LMP2 car. the gap between André Lotterer in the number one Rebellion and Mathias Besch in the number three car, the battle for third place, is coming down.
Oh my goodness, look at
the
this.
The Ferrari is actually pushing the Porsche up the straight. Would you get out of my way? And I think...
There you go, that's a big lift. On you go, mate, on you go.
Yeah, yeah, knock yourself out, sunshine. Good luck with eighth place. Have you seen the light? That's quite remarkable. Right, a cup of tea is coming my way, so I need a moment or two to sup it, which is very handy. Little replay of the Ferrari literally pushing the Porsche along the straight. And I think finally the frustration just boiled over a little there. And it might have been actually that Christensen had already decided not to quite give it 100% out of the Ford chicane and letting go by, and the Ferrari wasn't quite aware that that was happening.
Again, you know, they're thinking the same as us. The team probably did get on the radio to him and say, yeah, go on, let him go. Or he asked the team, perhaps.
Right, well, we're waiting for Hunky Dunky to have a quick chat. So down in the pit lane, Duncan is with the Ford team.
Thanks very much. Thank you very much, Martin. Yes, Billy Johnson, we catch back up with you. This is a follow-up interview because the last time I spoke to you, you had an incident with the car where something broke on it. How was your night after that?
After that, it was flawless. The team did a great job fixing the suspension. Car's back in one piece. We're out there turning laps. Unfortunately, we're a few laps down, so we're out of contention for the race. But we're leading the championship coming in, and we're trying to get as many points as we can to salvage out of this weekend. Hopefully we'll have a little bit more luck and a few more cars ahead of us will fall off to gain some valuable points for the super season.
Spoke to Scott Dixon earlier on. He said that the car seemed to be good, but it does struggle a bit with low track temperature. Is your setup the same?
Not quite sure, but for us it's a little bit hard to race because we don't have a lot of power getting off of the corners. We have okay top end, but by the time we get to that top end, it's at the end of the straightaway, so it's a little bit difficult to race at the moment as far as just the configuration of the BOP, but we're out there, we're turning laps, and like I said, we're trying to get as many points as possible.
Turning laps with a big smile as well.
Thanks.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Duncan. So, quick cup of tea, and it's been the first wagon wheel stop of the morning for Alan McNish.
He's got new wheels on his wagon.
That's the second wagon wheel stop. I think that's what those two fingers were intended to indicate. So he's on a two wagon wheel strategy for the morning stint. And I need to we're fast approaching 9 o'clock in the morning. Crikey, the morning is rocking on. It's Father's Day across the world, so Dad's watching. Happy Father's Day. Thank you to Sam for patting himself on the back. Thank you to Sam for my card. Happy birthday, Dad. And everybody else. There's an awful lot of dads here who probably on an annual basis feel fairly secondhand on Father's Day. An awful lot of dads as well whose Father's Day demand over the years is to be allowed to watch the television in peace until at least 3 o'clock in the afternoon. There you can see the serried ranks of monitors. So much is monitored live data transmission from the cars. Used to be the case in the early days of telemetry that it would all be a huge burst as you came past the pit lane. The entire lap would be downloaded in one squirt. But now the repeater aerials out in the forest are good enough that no longer do you need people on the end of a field telephone holding out pit boards down here at Mulsanne Corner, as they still used to do in the Group C era. You can now actually get radio communication pretty much everywhere. In fact, the mobile phone signals aren't so bad either, as they used to be. Used to be a little bit touch and go.
I tell you what, they're better than the UK, that's for sure.
I think they've put quite a lot of infrastructure in, maybe temporary, but they've done a good job. I think the phone signals this year are better by some margin than we've ever had before.
Just looking at that gap, the Buemi Conway gap, 41 seconds now, so that's getting slightly larger. I wonder whether that's intentional. I mean, yeah, I don't want to say anything I shouldn't say, but I think it'd be safer for them to just have a slightly bigger gap to make sure they get the cars in the right position.
Yeah, gap that could be coming down is the gap for third place, though. Lotterer and Besh, both the Rebellions, and they're doing roughly similar times, but generally it has came down over the last course of the couple of hours. Remember the number one car had a problem right from the word go in the first corner, where it slid wide, tagged the back of the Dragon Speed car, and the Dragon Speed car's had quite a few incidents since then, and the Rebellion itself has had a few problems as well with various trips into the pit box itself. And so for them, it's a case of making it to the end, because if they do, they'll be third and fourth. And then after that, it's which one of them is actually going to be the third place car, just buzzing past the Pro-Am of Ferrari, number 85.
Currently running third place with Keating at the wheel.
Ben Keating, who races a lot in IMSA, in the championship out there, WeatherTech, and the car is sponsored by WeatherTech.
Well, here's the 56 Porsche, lying fourth in the class, and Egidio Perfetti, one of the 39 rookies in the field. But I was saying during the night, he's a rookie here in the Le Mans 24 Hours. This is not his first race in a Porsche at Le Mans. And he's not done the Classic.
He did the Super Karting Cup race.
Did Road to Le Mans last year. So race here at Road to Le Mans. He did the Michelin Le Mans Cup last year. So a rookie, but he has raced two races at Le Mans. So in fact, he's had, before the start of the race and before the start of qualifying, half of two 55-minute races. So again, this is all part of the Road to Le Mans program, is you have the LMP3 field coming here and the GT3 cars, and the ambition then is to make the next step, isn't it? It is to get into the big race, and Egidio Perfetti has done exactly that. TF Sport have done the same. You know, a whole bunch of people. And we talked yesterday to the winner in the GT3 class, Christoph Ulrich, and his story was he came here 2 years ago for the first time as a fan, didn't really know much about Le Mans, came with friends, and was so utterly taken by this that he went away going, I've got to get a racing car. Last year he got a racing car. This year he's back, 2 years after visiting as a fan, he's back winning the race in Road to Le Mans Saturday morning at the 24-hour race. That's a pretty impressive, ambitious rate of progress. Mm.
So he'll be in the main event next year then?
He'll be on the top step of the podium overall in a P1 car, clearly. You know? So, yeah, I mean, that's just a great indication of what a hold this race can have on you in an instant. Out goes the third-place car, Pierre Thirier, got out of the car, and this is the 36 Signatec Alpine car, and that's André McGraw. Nicolas Lapierre's. Was that Pierre Thirier getting in? Or was he was taking over for Lapierre, was he? Okay, yes. I was going to say, it didn't look like Lapierre's helmet, although it had the right colours on it, they weren't in the right place. All the right notes, just not necessarily in the right order. Third place battle for best of the rest, and a spot on the overall podium still in the hands of Matthias Besch over André Lotterer. Gap went out a tenth of a second on the last sector. It is at 22 seconds.
Came down 4 seconds on the last lap, though, which I think was traffic related. Yeah. Because it was a 3:26 from Matthias Besch, 3:22. Two from André.
We've got two battles of teammates for the podium, haven't we? We've got the two Toyotas 40-odd seconds apart. We've got the two Rebellions 20-odd seconds apart. Alan's given me that. He's given me side eye.
Yeah, I think, you know,
we've got one battle between teammates.
Yeah, well,
at the moment, with 6 hours to go.
Yes, I know, but if you look at it, the eight has caught the seven by over 2 minutes and has now pulled 40 seconds gap.
Yeah.
So it's, without a shadow of a doubt, for whatever reason, the quicker car. and then you've got Lotterer, who's slightly quicker and catch.